So you can be in a garage and make it a house of God. You can be in a basement, out in a cabin. Forget the four walls and roof. You can be by a lake or in the woods somewhere. You know, as long as you're gathering with other believers and your praise becomes a place for Him to inhabit, the Lord to inhabit, to dwell, to live in, there you are. You have the house of God. The New Testament church is often met in the catacombs. All right, so basically they were down in the tombs, underground tombs. And yet their praise made those awful places a beautiful house of God because His church was there, inviting Him in with their worship. Now, while taking a few moments to define the word church might seem like a mini rabbit trail already in the message, it actually makes a case for what I'm going to be discussing over the next couple of weeks. The title of this week's message is What's in a Name? Now, you're all probably pretty familiar with one of the most famous quotes about names, and it's from Shakespeare's Romeo and Juliet, from which the title of today's message comes. What's in a name? That which we call a rose by any other name would smell as sweet. All right, it's a very famous quotation. But then there's my brother's interpretation. A rose by any other name is not a rose. You know, that's... But here's a few other folks' thoughts along those lines. A rose by any other name would smell as sweet, but would not cost half as much during the winter months.
Yeah, right.
I read a book once that a rose by any other name would smell as sweet, but I've never been able to believe it. I don't believe a rose would be as nice as if it was called a thistle or a stone cabbage. All right? You know, perspective is everything, right? And then we have the perfect name for the job. Sand Prairie Fire Department, his name is Lieutenant Les McBurney. So, you know, sometimes it's just the perfect name for the job. But then, you know, for any mom out there, this one is painfully familiar. You mean to tell me your real name isn't Mom? Mom. Yeah. Okay, so, but names are powerful. Names can define and names can describe. Formal names are the gateway in which we get, you know, acquainted with one another. And then, as time goes on, more informal names or familiar names acknowledge a deeper relationship. Nicknames, you know, pet names, you know, that kind of thing. Names have meanings. Now, one definition of the word name back in the 1300s was one's reputation, that which is commonly said about a person. So, kind of interesting. But today, the word name merely means, you know, a word by which a person or thing is denoted. You know, basically what you're called. But just a side thought, I think we should bring back that old definition, because, you know, maybe, you know, in general society we put a little more thought into what we name our kids, you know, and rather than what's trendy or cute or cool sounding, you know, that they would actually put some thought into what we name our kids. But, you know, the very same is true of God. God the Father, God the Son, Jesus, and God the Holy Spirit. There are many, many names of God throughout both the Old and New Testaments, and each of them are a gateway to get to know all three members of the Godhead better, more intimately, more closely acquainted. Now, some of them are names with which we're already pretty familiar, most of us are, but others maybe not so much, at least on a regular basis. So, you know, then there's the names in Scripture that God gives us, all right? The things that He calls us that we also should become more familiar with. Because, again, that gateway to deeper relationship is kind of, you know, it's a two-way street. God Jesus came, and it's the gospel in a nutshell. Now, most of this, you know, you've probably heard multiple, many times. You know, you've heard many messages about all of this. You know, been on the radar for years about God being Father, but, you know, if your relationship with your earthly Father has been difficult, again, it may not be something that you've actively pursued in your relationship with God. And that's why one of the most precious passages about God as our Heavenly Father comes from Romans chapter 8, verse 15. The Spirit you received does not make you slaves so that you live in fear again. The Spirit you received brought about your adoption to sonship, and by him we cry, Abba, Father. Now this is one that we've talked about before too, but you know, in this day and age, we don't normally refer to our fathers as Father, you know. Father. You know, we don't do that unless it's like a formal situation where maybe we're introducing him to someone, you know, hey Mike, this is my father, you know, I mean, and that kind of thing. But in today's vernacular, it's usually a more familiar address. We're usually calling him Dad or Daddy, or, you know, some folks use the word Pop. I've never understood that one. That sounds so funny. But, yeah, but you know, I mean, some people, you know, it's a more intimate, close address to our father, you know, Daddy. So Abba, you know, is the Aramaic word for Daddy. Now, Aramaic was the language that was being spoken at the time of Jesus, you know, but I love it, that Abba, you know. Harry has talked to us about that before, where it's kind of like the first words they would learn to speak, kind of like we would go Dada, they would go Abba, Abba, you know. And there's nothing that's more precious, nothing that's closer or more intimate than a little child saying, Daddy, you know? Whether it's, Daddy, watch me, or Daddy, help me, or Daddy, I love you. You know, there's nothing that melts the heart more. Go YouTube little cute little kid videos learning how to say Dad for the first time. You know, I mean, your heart melts. And I think when we finally get a hold of that idea as God, as our Heavenly Father, that he's likewise moved by our pleas when they're wrapped up in Abba. You know? Hey, we can't help it. Why, you know, we're in his image. Can you picture it? Can you imagine? When we come to him and we're like, Daddy God, Abba, help me. Or Abba, I love you. You know? I can't imagine that his heart would melt a little bit at hearing that. All right, so how did we get from formal, oh, I skipped a slide, sorry. How do we get from the formal God the Father to Abba? Well, let's begin at the beginning, all right? Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve, the cool of the day, walking in the garden with God, all right? Adam and Eve had the most amazing, incredible, intimate relationship with God. It was effortless. It was daily. It was continual. Alright? Enter Genesis chapter 3. You know, we know this part, the serpent, the apple, or whatever fruit that it actually was. Sin totally irreparably broke that so effortless close relationship. In fact, it broke it so badly that it also damaged the relationship between Adam and Eve themselves. And we're still living with the consequences of that damage today. In that breaking, the closeness with God ceased, the garden became unavailable, was off limits, and any relationship with God could only be had at great effort and dedication. Now, eventually with Abraham, God instituted sacrifice and covenant as the main avenue for maintaining relationship with him, but as we know, that only kicked the sin can down the road a little bit until the next sacrifice, and the next sacrifice, and the next, and the next, and the next. You know, the perpetual cycle that was instituted until the time was right for Jesus to come on the scene. And this distance is reflected in how God was addressed. Humanity went from that familial to the formal, from Abba to the Lord, Elohim, the Almighty, All-Powerful, Yahweh, which was the most holy, most revered name of God among the Israelites, was not allowed to be spoken out loud. So there's distance there between the holy and what we slaves of Egypt, Moses asks for his name, so God gives him his name, I Am has sent you. So Yahweh indicates God's the Father's self-existence and his ultimate authority. There is nobody more powerful or bigger than God. Alright? Now, with that prohibition of speaking the name Yahweh, a lot of Jews in Jesus' time would substitute the name Adonai, translated my Lord. Okay? Even that is, you know, it's a title. It's not that intimate closeness. And, you know, they're totally legitimate names, by the way, and that those meanings do have import for who God is in our lives. But, you know, it seems to me that in, even in English, that if we say, you know, Lord God or God the Father, it's kind of stiff, almost, you know, formal, almost an impersonal way to address him, if you know what I mean. All right? So all throughout the Old Testament, God the Father revealed his character and attributes through the judges and prophets, and yet that distance could only be closed so far. All right? That distance was physically demonstrated in the temple itself in Jerusalem. It's an outer court, the holy place, and the most holy place, or the Holy of Holies. And only the high priest could enter that Holy of Holies once a year with blood to sprinkle from the sacrifice that was made for the sins of all the people, for the entire nation, once a year. That was it. And the Holy of Holies was divided from the rest of the temple by a curtain, a very thick curtain, all right? And a very sense of visual reminder of what had been lost in the Garden of Eden. And then for 400 years after that, there was absolute silence from heaven. Not a single prophetic word to galvanize in Israel to seek deeper relationship with Adonai beyond what was already instituted at the temple, the sacrifices. And of Jesus, God the Son. Now, God, Jesus is God incarnate, God with skin on, if you will. And while he proclaimed his formal name, you know, he said, before Abraham was, I am. That's why the Pharisees were ticked off at him, by the way. One of the reasons was that he was openly declaring himself to be God. He was using that I Am name that he gave Moses, that God gave Moses, all right? So, so he was definitely declaring that he was God, but he was also here to deal with that sin problem that had been kicked down the road away, and to deal with it definitively. And he came to take care of that separation between us and God, came to demonstrate the love and the holiness of God the Father, right? He came to touch humanity, to experience life and death and resurrection, and to have humanity touch him back. Mary, Martha, Lazarus, the 12 disciples, the woman at the well, the woman with the issue of blood, the blind, the deaf, the lepers, the dead, okay? He brought with him a taste of what closeness with God is like. And in his death and resurrection, he purchased it for us. When he said, it is finished from the cross, that curtain in the temple that represented the separation between us and God was torn in half, completely ripped down the middle to open that up, to open up that access to God the Father. And I think it was Max Lucado who wrote and said, no doubt by an eager angel's hand, just tore that down. Boom. That gives me chills to think about that, you know, to picture that. And angels say, oh, hey, access to God is made open. This thing's gone. This thing's gone. He brought us back to Abba. Jesus brought us back to Abba. And I think that's why there's so many more descriptive, intimate names of Jesus throughout the New Testament. Look, I missed. I marked these usually in here, and I missed a couple of marks. The Son of Man, the Bread of Life, the Lord of the Sabbath, the Good Shepherd, Savior, Messiah, Emmanuel, God with us, the Prince of Peace, the Lamb of God, Advocate, Redeemer, this next week, we're